Hello everyone. Today we are going to take some more MCQs on management important topics. So today we are going to discuss some MCQs related to human resource management. Human resource management is almost 20 marks in the examination in the final paper, and therefore it holds immense importance. The topics that we are going to discuss today, the case studies that we are going to discuss today are recruitment and selection. Without wasting any time, let's start with our discussion. The first case study says, a company X Limited is setting up a new plant in India for manufacturing auto components. India has highly competitive and cost-effective production base in this sector. So these are the keywords here. Competitive and cost-effective production base is already present in the country. X Limited is planning to capture about 40% of the market share in India. That means it wants to hold a majority market share in the country and also export to the tune of at least 5 million in about 2 years of its planned operations. This shows that its motivations and its plans are very aggressive in nature. To achieve these targets, it requires a highly trained and motivated workforce. Another keyword here, highly trained and motivated workforce is required to achieve these aggressive targets that the company has. Let's have a look at the first question. Which of the following alternatives to recruitment seems to be the most appropriate given that the company wants flexibility in responding to future changes, a keyword here, in the demand of workers and save labor cost, because the market is very cost effective. So it wants to save labor cost, and it also wants the labor to be flexible in nature with respect to whatever changes happen in the future. Now, what can be the best way to inculcate to find out labor when these two requirements have to be met? Contract labor is the best method because it is temporary in nature, number one. So it is flexible, it is not permanent, and secondly, contract labor is always cheaper compared to permanent labor force. So the answer has to be temporary employment, which is a form of contract labor only. Now, employee leasing, the problem is leasing is always for a long term, and therefore flexibility is not present there. Overtime will increase the labor cost, and overtime is not a method of recruitment. Overtime happens after people have been recruited, after employees have been recruited already. So the answer is C, temporary employment here. The benefits of temporary employment are relatively low labor cost, easy access to experienced labor, and flexibility. Disadvantage, do not know the culture or workflow of the firm, but this is not a requirement. Although the question says that it requires a highly motivated workforce, and when can motivation come? Motivation can come from two things. Either you're paying them well, so money can provide motivation, or they can connect with the culture of the organization. Now, that motivation cannot be generated here because there is a difference between what the case study is saying and what the question is asking. The case study says that the company wants to have a highly trained and motivated workforce. Highly trained workforce can be generated in contract employment, but highly motivated workforce is difficult to find. But the question does not talk about motivation at all. The question talks about two things, flexibility and labor cost, and therefore contract labor is the best option here. The second question says, which of the following provides complete job related information? A very good question. Job compatibility questionnaire, job screening, all of the above, realistic job reviews. So what happens is, in realistic job review, you provide information related to the job, what the job entails, what the job wants you to work. In job compatibility question, this job compatibility questionnaire is the next step. It's the step after realistic job reviews. And what happens in JCQ is, job information has already been identified. So the compatibility between job information and, on the other hand, the abilities of the employee, abilities of the person who is applying, the compatibility between these two is measured under job compatibility question. And the third one is job screening, wherein you screen people on the basis of their abilities, on the basis of their qualifications. So after compatibility has been identified, some people will leave, some people will stay, and the whoever stays, there will be a job screening process wherein you're not providing any job related information anymore. What you're doing is, you're screening out people. For example, if there are 10 people who have applied, after they have understood that they are compatible for the job, after the organization has understood that they are compatible with the job, then there will be a job screening process wherein, let's say, 4 of them are removed and 1 remains. So this is called as job screening. Therefore, there is no provision of providing complete job related information in job screening as well. So the answer is realistic job previews. The information provided, as I said, helps job seekers to evaluate the compatibility among the jobs and their personal ends before hiring decisions are made. So the next step is JCQ. Which of the following acts as a barrier to effective selection? A very good question. There are a total of 5 barriers to effective selection. Perception, what is the, let's understand the meaning of perception. Perception says the inability to understand others accurately is called as perception, which means that you perceive someone as having a certain kind of personality. For example, a person comes in the organization, a very basic example I'll take. You are following the recruitment and selection process. It is on, and some people have been called for interview. Let's say a total of 5 employees, or let's say 5 job seekers, more accurate word here, have been called for interview. Out of these 5, 2 turn in late because of, let's say, a strike in the buses. A bus strike in the city has resulted in some people getting late because they do not have access to metro. The metro stations are not available in their areas. So these 2 people have got late. Now you, being the person who is selecting them, being the interviewer, has no idea about the bus strike. And you believe that if there is a bus strike, they can very well come through the metro. So you perceive that these people are lazy, or these people are latecomers, and a personality tag has been put on them. So this is called as perception. This is going to act as a barrier to effective selection. The next one is fairness. Fairness is that no individual or candidate should be discriminated against on the basis of, let's say, religion, region, gender, race, all these things. This happens a lot in the organizations. There are many organizations which, you know, discriminate against people on the basis of gender. A lot of multinational companies do not hire women, or do not hire women at higher levels, just because they think that these that the women cannot work, are not flexible with their work, because they also have responsibilities of the home. So it also acts as a barrier to effective selection. The third one is validity. Validity is a test that helps predict job performance of the incumbent, of the employee. A test that has been validated can differentiate between the employees who can perform well and who will not. So you tend to identify and find out who can perform well and who cannot perform well in the future. That is called as validity. All these 3 are barriers to effective selection. The 4th one and the 5th one are reliability, and the 5th one is pressure. So the answer is D, all of the above. What is reliability? A reliable method is one that produces consistent results when repeated n number of times. But no method can be called as completely reliable, because there will always be some differences. So if there is less reliability, it acts as a barrier to effective selection. And pressure is, if there is any pressure through politicians, bureaucrats, relatives, friends, all these also act as barriers to effective selection. I hope you have understood this question. Let's go on to the next one. Ashish, the marketing head, Raman, the human resource manager of senior enterprise, decide to leave the company. So there are these 2 people, Ashish, who is the marketing head, and Raman, who is the human resource manager. The CEO of the company, called Jyoti is another human resource manager, and requested her to fill up the vacancies before leaving the organization. Informing that a subordinate, Ms. Alka Pandit, was very competent and trustworthy, Jyoti suggested that if she could be moved up in the hierarchy, she would do the needful. The CEO agreed for the same. Ms. Alka Pandit contacted Keith recruiters who advertised for the post of marketing head for senior enterprises. They were able to recruit a suitable candidate for the company. Raman's vacancy was filled up by screening the database of unsolicited applications lying in the office. That means, unsolicited means voluntary applications lying in the office. People who had applied before for the same post or for any other post, those applications were picked up again and they were screened by the agency. Which of the following tests are used to measure a prospective employee's motivation to function in a particular environment? A very good question. Now, we are talking about motivation to function is a particular environment. These are the keywords here. Ability test will talk about the ability of the person, will talk about how capable he is in the organization in that particular job. So, it is not talking about motivation at all. Aptitude also talks about capability, intelligence, capability. So, therefore, motivation is not present here. Personality and interest are the two confusing terms here. How do we differentiate between them? What happens in interest test is you find out the interest of an individual, of an incumbent, towards a particular job. How interested he is towards a particular job, towards a particular organization, towards a particular vision. That is called as interest. So, personality test tests the combination of aptitude, interest, mood and temperament, which determines the overall personality of the individual. And if the overall personality of the individual is good, is positive, that means he would be motivated to work in any kind of environment or the environment that the organization poses itself on or the organization provides. So, personality test is an overall or a complete comprehensive test of the individual, whereas interest test measures only the interest of the individual with respect to the job, with respect to the vision, with respect to the organization, and therefore it does not test the motivation in a particular environment. It tests only the motivation to do or not to do a particular job. Therefore, C, interest test, is not correct. The answer is B, personality test. Which of the following refers to the term yield ratio? It is available in the book Aswathappa, a very important term which can be asked in the examination and which can be very confusing because yield ratio is also available in finance practical. So, we often confuse it with the yield ratio that is available in finance, that is taught in finance numerical portion. Ratio of interviewed candidates to selected candidates, ratio of applicant inputs to outputs, ratio of applicants to vacancies, none of the above. The answer to this question is B. Let's understand the ratio of inputs to outputs very briefly here. Yield ratio measures the ratio of input to output. So, this is the first ratio that we have. Input is 1200, output is 200. The second one is input to output is 1200. The input remains the same. The output changes to 150. The third output is 100 and the input remains the same again, 1200. And the fourth output and the final output is 50. And the input is 1200. So, the ratio of input to output at different time periods, levels is called as yield ratio here. So, the yield, first yield ratio is 1200 upon 200, 6 is to 1. The second is 1200 upon 150, 8 is to 1. Third is 1200 upon 100, 12 is to 1. And fourth is 1200 upon 50, 24 is to 1. So, this is called as yield ratio. So, the answer very clearly is ratio of applicant inputs, which remains the same, to outputs at various decision points. Outputs at various decision points keeps changing. The next question is, there are several factors which influence recruitment process. Which of the following is an internal factor influencing recruitment? Now, there are two things about recruitment. There are factors influencing recruitment and there are sources of recruitment. There are internal sources and external sources of recruitment. There are internal factors affecting recruitment. There are external factors affecting recruitment. Both these things have been discussed in the book Aswathappa and they've also been discussed in T.N. Chhabra or C.B. Gupta of HRM. So, if you go through them, you will find these two things very clearly. Unemployment, even if you don't know, you can answer this question actually. Just think a little and read the question and the answer choices very carefully. Unemployment rate. Unemployment, is it affected by the organization? No, it is more affected by the economy. If there is more unemployment in the economy, there are less jobs in the economy is not doing well, then it is also going to affect recruitment process of the organization. So, it's an external factor. Similarly, labor market. Let's say there is not enough supply of labor. There's not enough supply of labor. So, the recruitment process is going to get affected because if there's not enough supply, then the labor will get, it will be difficult to find labor. At the same time, the labor will get costly. So, that is going to affect recruitment process. Supply and demand of labor, as I discussed in the labor market itself, they are external factors. Growth and expansion. Growth and expansion is talking about growth and expansion of the enterprise and not growth and expansion of the economy. So growth and expansion of the enterprise is going to affect recruitment. When the organization is growing fast, that means, or at that point, the organization is going to recruit more people. An organization registering growth and expansion will have more recruiting on hand than the one which finds its fortunes declining. So growth and expansion is an internal factor. A very good question on the process of recruitment. This is the entire process of recruitment. We have to rearrange it based on the correct chain. Searching, evaluation, and control. Control always comes towards the end. So just this should be the last one. So A and D are automatically eliminated. So we have B and C. Planning, screening, strategy development. What happens in the starting? You always plan. Whenever you have not talked about or read about recruitment, you must have read about POCCC, planning, organization, commanding, coordinating, and controlling. So these are the three processes. POCCC. Here also, planning is always going to be the first one. Here also, it should be the first one. So the answer comes out to be B. 35142. Let's check it. Planning is the first one. After planning, what we'll do? We will create a strategy. After a strategy has been created, we will search for the required people. When we have found out people, we will screen those people, and towards the end, we will evaluate those people and control the process in order to find out the problems with the recruitment process. So this should be the correct method. This is all about questions on recruitment and selection. I hope you like the lecture. Tomorrow we'll talk about some more questions, some more case studies related to human resource management or organization behavior and organization theory. These questions are directly connected or in line with the quality of questions that are asked in the examination. So I expect you, and I hope that you will go through these questions on a regular basis, go through all these MCQs very seriously, so that you are able to understand what kind of questions are asked and you are able to score better in the upcoming examination.